Please be seated. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." And St. Paul wrote, "I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." So I would like to welcome you all today to this service in which we remember Charlie McNabb and offer our prayers to God. Today we offer ourselves to God in the knowledge that he is able to meet our every need. We thank God for life and goodness, and we commend Charlie's soul into God's eternal care. In all of this, we look to God for our strength. To that end, let us pray. God of all consolation, in your unending love and mercy, you turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life. Show compassion to your people in their sorrow. Be our refuge and our strength to lift us from the darkness of grief to the peace and light of your presence. Your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by dying for us, conquered death, and by rising again, restored life. May we then go forward eagerly to meet him, and after our life on earth, be reunited with our brothers and sisters where every tear will be wiped away. We ask this through Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen. We set the wider context for our service today with the reading of the eulogy, and I'll be reading it on behalf of Charlie's family, who has written it. Charlie McNabb was born November 28, 1925, on Northwest 16-50-19, west of the 3rd, to Gordon Alexander and Catherine Ann McNabb. He was the second son in a family of 11 children. Dad had many stories from his childhood, walking, riding, and even skiing, sometimes two to a set of skis, to Daysville School. In the morning, they would walk the milk cows over to a pasture, and then on the way home, bring them back home. The thing was, the pasture wasn't on a direct path to the school. Dad's older sisters, Chrissy, Elsie, and Margaret, had the job of helping the younger ones get ready for school. They all agreed Charlie was the fussiest to get ready. All wrinkles must be out, socks straight, and in the right clothes. Dad stayed like that and was always particular about his clothes. Dad often spoke of Grandpa Gordon's huge potato patch, garden and orchard, also a huge raspberry patch. And Dad spoke of Grandma Catherine's cooking, scones, baking, canning, and pies. We heard a lot about all the hard work that went on, but most often these stories were filled with the fun times and great friends during the work. One summer, Brother Gordon and Dad, as teenagers, sent to the flats where Jake and Caitlin now live, to hay. They camped out all summer, putting up the hay for their dad. They'd come home on the weekends or sooner if bad weather, and their mom would stock them up on food. Dad would laugh and cringe about how bad the mosquitoes were. And Dad and Gordon had lots of laughs over those times. Dad said his sisters were always playing tricks on the boys, but the sisters often said it was the other way around. There were 7 girls before a boy, and the girls said Gordon and Dad were spoiled because by the time they came along, all the hard chores were done. Dad and our mom's family, the Stewarts, grew up visiting often and were close as families homesteading in the area. Mom was actually Auntie Jean's friend, as Dad put it. But when Jean started getting letters that Margaret was coming home from the Air Force to take nursing in Saskatoon, Dad began thinking of the opportunities for them. Before long, Mom had moved to Turtleford to nurse and was a regular guest at the McNabs. Mom and Dad were married on August 20th, 1951. Their first home was near Gordon and June McNabs, the Stacy place, and this house is still standing. Dad said it was the coldest place they ever lived in. Later, they moved to the McLaughlin place. That became Greg and Debbie's home. In 1981, they moved to Mervyn. Dad truly adored Mom and was devoted to her, and she was devoted to him. Mom and Dad had six children, and Dad was always about family. He spent each morning in routine calls to each of his kids. Mom was just as interested, and each day they planned how they could help. Dad went to the farm each day, putting in long hours even after moving to town until he eased into retirement. Then finally, he started playing golf, fishing, bowling, and playing cards. He spent many hours with Mom and all of their grandchildren. Dad always said he was a lucky man being able to farm first with his dad, then with his brothers, Gordon and Alan, and then with his sons, Glenn, Greg, and Gary. My dad was known as a very fussy farmer and a good cattleman. While farming was always part of Dad, he was also a cowboy. He drove teams of horses, rode horses, and chased cows. Well into his 80s, he still got on and went for rides. At age 80, Nick and Charlene were moving cows, and Dad said, "Where's my horse?" So we said he could have one of the kids or Charlene's horse. He responded with, "I want that one. I'm not riding a deadhead." And he pointed at Nick's horse. Nick and Charlene were terrified as he took the horse, kicked it in the ribs, and disappeared over the hill. Dad had many jobs in his early years. One was he went logging in northern Ontario with friend Henry Knight and two others who didn't stay. Henry couldn't drive a team, but Dad could. The teams were big, and Henry could bridle and help harness them because Dad said he was so strong. So their job was to go into the bush and cut the logs into lengths to put onto the sleigh bunk. The problem was it was a two-man bucksaw they used to cut with, and it was dull and difficult to sharpen. So they were struggling with this and, of course, being paid by the cord. Well, Dad heard there was a fellow at the camp that was good at sharpening the saws, but very expensive to get him to do it. So Dad heard this fellow liked to play poker on Thursday nights, and Dad told Henry he was going to play. Henry was worried Dad would lose all the money they had made. Dad said he was going. The night ended with Dad winning all the money this man had, about $90, a huge amount in those days. And when he went to leave, he gave the man his money back and said, "Just keep my saw sharp." And he did. After that, Henry and Dad were away, and the logging went much better. Dad always said he honed his card skills, playing his brothers Gordon and Alan, Ben Rooks, Tommy Jones, Claire Wilkinson, and Andy Belanger. After he and Henry were back, Henry would often mention that Dad should have only given half the money back to the man that sharpened the saw. Dad always answered, "I never wanted the man's money. I only wanted a good, sharp saw." That was Dad. When Dad came back, he said he had money in his pocket, something which was new to him, but some of his siblings were going through tough times, and Grandma asked if he could help. So he gave almost all of it to Grandpa to disperse it. Farming could wait. He had a huge heart. Dad also spent several years working construction with his brother-in-law, Bill Miners. They helped build Battleford's Union Hospital and the Prince Charles Hotel in Lloydminster. While they were in Lloydminster, they were invited to go see the first oil well south of Lloydminster in the Lone Rock area. Dad loved to laugh and hear a good joke. He made friends easily and kept them for life. He spent some time net fishing at Turtle and Brightsand Lake with Alan and Lawrence George. He had good friends and neighbors, Bill Bannerman, Bobby Cormack, Milton Conacher, and Andy Belanger. Dad and Andy were responsible for a few tricks around Mervyn. They played them on each other and any other unsuspecting neighbor. Dad helped to build the curling rink, golf course, the bowling alley, the ballpark, and the church. He didn't curl or bowl much, but loved the community, and he loved to watch the kids play ball. Mom and Dad also traveled a bit. They went on trips with family and friends. They enjoyed holidays, but were always happy to be home. Dad was a tough little man. He was in a combining accident in 1964 and was ran over by the combine. He was told he'd never walk again due to a crushed pelvis, and as we know, he did walk again. From that accident, he was troubled with issues, but he dealt with it. He had cancer twice and surgeries both times. He had crushed vertebrae twice, once when a bull tried to squash him. He had a strong heart and was able to make 97 plus years. Our dad had a good life, and I think he would tell you all that. He lost the love of his life, our mom, December 7, 2018. He thought he couldn't go on after that, and yet he did. Even when he needed more help, he wanted to be home. He was always interested in his family and so wanted to be independent. He spent hours sitting at his kitchen table playing solitaire, checking on his kids, and keeping an eye on George Smith's comings and goings. Dad, we will miss you every day. Your love, support, little anecdotes, and your laugh. You go be with all that went before you that lately you've been thinking so much about. Your mom and dad, your wife, sons and family, and many good friends. We will miss you here on earth, but have felt fortunate to have such a good dad. It is not goodbye. We will meet again. Until then, we love you always, your family. Two more things in this section of our service. Next, we're going to hear some memories from grandchildren, so I'd invite them to come forward.
Our grandpa had a heart of gold. He loved his family, and nothing made him happier than being able to spend time with them. He had a large herd between 6 kids, their spouses, 18 grandchildren, and 38 great-grandchildren. He loved to spend precious time with all of us, and it was important to him to keep up with each of the families as they grew. Nikki and I would like to share a few memories from each of the grandchildren about our Grandpa Charlie.
Grandpa loved being the center of entertainment. He always made room for everyone at the table and insisted that there were more chairs that we could pull out and squeeze in. Tasha put it best when she said that time spent at the kitchen table were like moments of heaven on earth. He loved to offer a drink on special occasions and kept Coke on hand for this reason. Whenever you were at Grandpa's and ask for a pop, he'd always say, "Sure, take whatever you want, but be sure to leave me a Coke or two in case I need it."
As the grandsons grew up, he loved sneaking us into the kitchen and teasing us. He'd wonder if we could handle something a little stiffer than just a Coke. He'd pour us a drink in a crystal glass and pat us on the back as we took a seat together.
Grandpa always kept snacks of all kinds on hand. You could always be sure that he'd have something special tucked away for when the kids came to visit. There was always a large jug of peppermint patties that he hid in his closet, after eights in the fridge, strawberry marshmallows in the cupboard, and Cheetos beside his chair in the living room. If you were staying for supper, and he'd always end a meal saying that he was too full to eat another bite, and after a moment, he'd ask Grandma if they should get out the ice cream from the freezer. Grandpa was a bit of a trickster. Grandpa's favorite was trying to pull a fast one on you and seeing if you'd believe it. As we grew up, we'd tell our own made-up stories to Grandpa and try to fool him. More often than not, he'd say, "Oh, you're just pulling my leg." Lori recalls how much Grandpa loved April Fool's Day and would play tricks on everyone. It became a race to see who could trick Grandpa first. One year, we got carried away scheming, and Lori called Grandpa early to say that we had a cow calving and Dad was gone to work and needed help. Grandma had answered the call and said that she would send Grandpa right away. After Lori hung up, we giggled about how good of tricksters we were. When Mom asked us what was so funny, we told her what we'd done. Mom told us that we'd better call back right away and say April Fools. We argued that Grandpa would know what it was, and Lori called anyway. It was too late. Grandpa was already on his way to help with the imaginary crisis. We were in big trouble with Mom that we'd played such a mean trick on Grandpa, to the point where he was driving all the way to the farm to help us. She told us how we'd better apologize to him and hope he wasn't too mad. Well, Grandpa showed up soon enough, and he wasn't mad at all. He laughed that Lori had got him on her own and said it looked like for a good day for tea at the Bannerman farm.
Aside from joking, Grandpa loved to sit quietly at the kitchen table, twiddling his thumbs and watching the birds. Many moments were spent watching the birds, feeding the birds, or telling the grandchildren to settle down before they scared the hummingbirds away. Many grandchildren and even the great-grandchildren helped Grandpa fill the bird feeders.
Hours were spent at the kitchen table, eating, laughing, and playing card games that Grandma and Grandpa taught us. First, we learned the basics with Go Fish and Snap, and soon we moved on to King in the Corner, Solitaire, and Crazy Eights. But it was crib that Grandpa liked best, although I'm sure Grandma did most of the teaching. She would teach us how to count points and strategize, and she'd go easy on us while we were learning, but Grandpa was the real competition. He'd always ask, "Are you any good yet? Do you think you can beat me? Maybe we should play something more your speed, like Snap." That one really cracked himself up. And if you were really unfortunate and lagging behind in the game, he'd giggle, sniff the air, and say, "Smells a little skunky in here." Grandpa loved to win at cards. Grandpa loved to goad us during a game of crib and say, "Are you sure you want to do that? Or why don't you play your five? Surely you've got an ace in there. I'm going to peg all the way to the end on you." He also loved it when you fell into a trap and paired him. Just when you were reveling in the fact that you had suckered him out and got a couple of points, he'd pull out another of the same card and make it three of a kind. Oh, how he used to laugh when it worked. In all truth, there were times that Grandpa lost. He'd pretend to be humble and he'd say, "Well, I can't beat you every time or you won't come back and play again." Grandpa often told us that he needed tougher competition because it was just getting too easy. Well, Grandpa, I'm sure between Grandma and all of your siblings up in heaven, you've got a lot of games of crib ahead of you. Grandpa and Grandma's kitchen table wasn't the only place that we spent hours visiting. Grandpa always had a ball game or a hockey game on, and he loved to watch them. Grandpa cheered for the Blue Jays, and if you knew what was good for you, you did too. Grandma would be knitting away, and he'd be constantly telling her, "Did you see that? They got a run."
It's been mentioned before that Grandpa was a bit of a fussy little man. He was very particular, especially with his clothing and his haircuts. Thankfully, Rebecca kept his hair looking sharp. Jesse remembers being a young boy when Grandpa would take him and Jake to St. Walburg to get their hair cut. The boys felt special and grown up that Grandpa would take them along, but Jesse said the best part of the trip was going to the bakery and picking up Long John donuts to share on the ride home. After Jesse went on to do horseshoeing, Grandpa asked him if he was any good at it. Jesse told him he thought so, but he needed more experience. And Grandpa told Jesse that to do horseshoeing, you have to have a strong back and a weak mind. Then he laughed so hard that he spit his bottom teeth out.
I remember leading Lori into all kinds of mischief. I would steal Grandpa's comb from his pocket, and Lori and I spent many evenings combing and styling his hair. Once in a while, it would get kind of staticky, and we'd use some water to settle it down. But I really pushed his buttons when I would steal Grandma's Neutrogena hand lotion from the counter and plaster it all over his head. I'd give a good scalp massage and comb the lotion all through his hair, achieving the perfect look, greasy hair and all. Grandpa would ask the whole time, "What are you doing back there? I hope it's not a mess." And I'd sweetly answer that it wasn't done yet. Eventually, Lori and I would stop her cackling and we'd go and get a mirror and do a big reveal. Grandpa would just laugh it off and say that Grandma needed to keep that locked up a little higher and then go to wash it out. What a patient man. Speaking of hair, Tanya remembers being at Grandma and Grandpa's while her mom and dad were away. Grandpa would braid her hair and joke that he learned how to do that from braiding horses' tails. Grandpa loved having his family around him at all times. He called each of his children every day for a report on how they were doing. She says she could only hope to be as loving and generous as Grandpa. He had such a big heart with so much room in it for all of us. Grandpa loved summertime and being outdoors. He spent many hours touring to all the farms to see his kids and grandkids. Janelle would be at Grandma and Grandpa's while he was getting ready to head out the door and go to one of the farms. Grandma had always sent him with the best lunch, cheese and crackers, cookies, tea with cream and sugar. Grandma always packed extra for the grandkids that would be in the tractor too. The lunches were made with so much love. In later years, when Janelle and Ryan got married and had their family, Grandpa would always check in on them. If she came to visit without Ryan, Grandpa would say, "That guy works too hard." And if Ryan came to visit too, Grandpa would always tell him that he should be in the field and not out gallivanting. He loved the kids so much, and he always loved to see them and to tease them about everything. They will miss him so much.
Mike spent his share of time with Grandpa in the International Tractor. Grandpa always shared his snacks, and Mike recalls often having over-sugared tea and eating his Velveeta cheese and crackers. Cole also spent a lot of time with Grandpa at the farm. He'd ride around in the tractor in a haze of cigarette smoke, drinking all of his tea and eating his cheese and crackers. Once they even had to spend all morning searching for Grandpa's teeth in the stubble. One of Cole's favorite memories happened when he was about 10. They were in the tractor harrow packing on the home quarter. Grandpa took the corner a little wide and took out 10 or 12 posts. He remembers saying, "Grandpa, I think you're in the fence." He just about jumped out of his seat and he grabbed every gear but the brakes. As kids, Tracy and Charlie also rode in the tractor with Grandpa and ate whatever treats Grandma had sent. More recently, they remember how happy he was to drive down to the rink in Mervyn and watch all of his great-grandchildren skate. Jake remembers spending countless hours in the old truck shooting gophers. Grandpa would take him all over, south of Debbie's to Diane's, over to Gary's, and up the Crick Road back home. Along the way, they'd stop for coffee. Janaea golfed many rounds with Grandpa, and his advice was always the same. "Keep your eye on the ball. Just keep your head down and I'll watch where it goes." He would repeat this over and over while Janaea continued to top ball after ball. He always asked and genuinely cared about Kirk and their kids. He'd say, "What are the big kids up to these days? And where are those two little girls that come in here cartwheeling all the way to the living room?"
Tasha remembers that Grandpa always made a point of coming to see them for a horse ride, a ride in the cutter, and to see the new foals. A couple of years ago, he gave her son Charlie his fishing rod and tackle box. They all shed some tears that day, knowing how much it had meant to him and that his fishing days were officially over. A couple of months ago, she stopped to see Grandpa and pick up little Charlie from her mom. She'd been having a rough day and was feeling sad. She wanted to go home and cry, but decided to sit down beside Grandpa because he was sad too. She saw in his eyes that he missed Grandma terribly. They held hands and sobbed together. He modeled faithful, dedicated, and tender love to us and to our grandma. Tasha loved his laughter, his tenderness, and his teasing, and his kind heart. She says she was blessed tremendously to have a grandpa like him. Her son, Charlie, shortened up great-grandpa Charlie's name to just Great Charlie, and we think he got it right.
Bruce remembers the hundreds of trips to the farm, fishing and hunting. He feels blessed to have spent so much time with Grandpa. Craig went on many fishing trips with Grandpa and Andy. Grandpa taught Craig that fishing was much more about the visiting and joking as it was about catching fish. Craig says even if they never caught anything, they spent time together, which was just as important. Craig will always remember how soft it was to run around barefoot on Grandpa's grass, because it was maintained like a golf course. He also remembers the countless card games and family gatherings around the kitchen table.
Grandpa loved to tell stories and sing old-time ditties. Grandpa also loved to sing an old song just to crack a smile. He led the group often in singing Auld Lang Syne every New Year's. He had many songs like Clementine, Show Me the Way to Go Home, and It Ain't Gonna Rain No More.
One of my favorite things to do with Grandpa was to listen to music. We'd put on a record or a CD, laugh and cry while talking about happy days gone by. Grandpa told stories of growing up with 10 siblings and working hard on the farm. One of Trent's things he enjoyed most were the stories Grandpa would tell about being a young man and the people that he interacted with. Trent's favorites were about Grandpa logging in Ontario one winter with Henry Knight, throwing hay on the rack with Jack Stewart, driving a team to Louisville to fill it with hay to meet Mr. Pilling, and hitting the ditch with Wynard Ballingood. Katie moved into Mervyn in August of 2015, just across the back alley from Grandma and Grandpa. She loved raising Oscar so close to them. There were times when Oscar would run over in his gitchies. They would arrive there and Grandpa would ask, "Did you come the short way across the backyard or did you come the long way on the road?" Neither trail was more than 100 steps, but he loved to make a joke that they were so close together. Katie says that she won't be able to look out across the two backyards without a certain longing in her heart, knowing that they are no longer there. She loves them dearly and will always miss them.
Saying goodbye at Grandma and Grandpa's was no quick thing. Parents would call their kids and say, "Come and say goodbye and give Grandma and Grandpa a kiss." And they would talk some more, say goodbye, talk some more, and say bye again. Finally, they'd gather towards the door. Grandma and Grandpa always came to the door to wave. Out on the steps, Grandpa had his own way to say goodbye, and the more you tried to hurry, the sillier he would get. "Drive safe and watch for the deer and the moose and the skunks and the porcupine and the bears, and call me when you get home."
Thank you so much. And to conclude this part of our remembrance, we have some grandchildren to sing a song in memory of their grandpa. Grandpa, tell me about the good old days.
Thank you. Tell me about the good old days. Sometimes it feels like this world's gone crazy.
Grandpa, take me back to yesterday, when the line between right and wrong didn't seem so hazy.
Did lovers really fall in love to stay and stand beside each other come what may? Was a promise really something people kept, not just something they would say and then forget? Did families really bow their heads to pray? Did daddies really never go away? Oh, Grandpa, tell me about the good old days.
Grandpa, everything is changing fast. We call it progress, but I just don't know.
Grandpa, let's wander back into the past and paint me the picture of long ago.
Did lovers really fall in love to stay, stand beside each other come what may? Was a promise really something people kept, not just something they would say and then forget? Did families really bow their heads to pray? Did daddies really never go away? Oh, Grandpa, tell me about the good old days. Did lovers really fall in love to stay and stand beside each other come what may? Was a promise really something people kept, not just something they would say and then forget? Did families really bow their heads to pray? Did daddies really never go away? Oh, Grandpa, tell me about the good old days. Oh, Grandpa, tell me about the good old days.
Thank you all. Well remembered and well honored. And so we take some time now prayerfully to remember the members of Charlie's family, those who have passed on before and those who mourn his passing. So Charlie was predeceased, of course, by his beloved wife, Margaret, by two of his sons, Glenn and Greg, by his 10 siblings. He survived by daughter Lori and husband Keith, daughter Mary Lynn and husband Bob, daughter Charlene and husband Nick, son Gary and wife Bonnie, my daughters-in-law Diane and Debbie. He's also survived by 18 grandchildren, Tracy and James, Charlie and Mark, Clint, Cole and Janessa, Bruce and Martha, Janaea and Kirk, Janelle and Ryan, Tanya and Paul, Craig and Michela, Tasha and Delbert, Katie, Trent and Casey, Michael and Jolene, Rebecca and Garrett, Jesse and Carly, Jake and Caitlin, Nikki and Lori and Michael, together with 38 great-grandchildren. Charlie is also survived by a sister-in-law, Louise, and brother-in-law, Johnny. And Charlie, indeed, has quite the amazing heritage. So today we would remember all of you, Charlie's family, and offer our prayers for you in the time ahead. I ask all of us now to join with me in a moment of silence, each to make our remembrance of Charlie in our own way and to remember his family in prayer. Please join me then in a moment of silence. We thank you, God, for the good things of Charlie's life, which were your gift to us. We ask that you would continue to support and sustain his family by your goodness and your mercy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I was also asked to read this word of thanks from the family. Dad was very fortunate to have such good people taking care of him this past while. Thank you to all the home care girls. Tammy Blakeney, Dad loved that you took time for a crib game before you left. Thank you to Chris Conacher, Kathy Broughton, Krista Eclarino, and Eleanor Stein. You helped us give Dad what he really wanted, and that was to be in his own home. We will always remember that. Also mentioned that those who wish to make a memorial donation, the family suggests donations be made to the Canadian Cancer Society or to the Turtleford Hospital Auxiliary or to a charity of your choice. The interment will occur immediately after the service and will be followed by a lunch here at the Hill, at the Hall. Now, as we transition into our scripture readings and prayers, let's sing our hymn, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace.
Let me bring your love.
please be seated. Our first reading is taken from the 11th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, beginning at the 17th verse. It's one of those stories in which God, through Jesus, gives a profound blessing to Jesus' friends. It's the story of the raising of Lazarus. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother shall rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." Next, I'll read for you a familiar psalm, Psalm 23. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall lack for nothing. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Finally, from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11, Jesus' words to us, "All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." Well, I want to reflect with you today on these readings, but before I do, I just wanted to make mention of something in Psalm 23, "Thou anointest my head with oil." And that reminded me of that story that we heard about the hand cream and the hair. Surely that was a sign of God's love. Well, our first reading is part of the story of Jesus raising Lazarus, his friend, to life. The first part of the story tells of Jesus being sent a message that Lazarus is ill, and rather than immediately going, he waits. When he arrives in Bethany, as we heard, he's told that Lazarus has died. And I mention this because it's important for us to remember that Jesus knew what was happening. He was aware of the situation, and his timing was intentional. He was not being insensitive, but rather he was doing what he knew needed to be done. Well, as he arrives, Martha says to him, "Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died." Well, they are the words of one who does not understand the things which are overwhelming her. Yet even then, she goes on to say, "But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." And then Jesus goes on to reassure her that her brother will rise again and says of himself, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? And Martha responds with a yes, and the story continues. And so beyond what I read, Jesus goes on to perform the miracle of calling Lazarus back to life. Now, Lazarus, being human, would die again, but Jesus' point, of course, is that there is a wider life, eternal life, in view. His raising of Lazarus back to this life was an amazing pointer to the deeper reality of the promise of heaven, a promise which is in God's power to fulfill. Like Martha, we move from time to time through events in our life which change everything, which often overwhelm us, even when we think we are prepared for them. But the message of this story of Jesus is that he knows our circumstances and has the power to change the circumstances of our life. But even more amazingly, he has the power to change our eternal destiny, to bring us to life everlasting with God. Now, in spite of all the good things we accomplish, we are all prone to the limitations of life. We are all prone to sin, to make mistakes, prone to find ourselves in circumstances from which we cannot recover in our own strength and power. And in the end, we must all face death. But in the light of all of that, can there be blessing here? Well, this is the question. This question is the one to which Jesus has the answer. For in the story of Jesus' visit to Lazarus and his family that day is the message that there is blessing in the here and now and blessing forever after. And it is to be found in the hand of God, which is in the person of Jesus. And that's why he asked Martha if she believes that he is the resurrection and the life, because blessing is at hand. And we need to believe in the one who has power to change our lives and to bring about our destiny to be children of God. It is for us to know and love God and be loved and blessed by God forever. It's not in our power to live. It is in Jesus' power. So today, as we give thanks for the blessings we have received from God through Charlie's life and love, to Jesus' great and wonderful power, to the one who is the resurrection and the life, we commend Charlie. Let us also, each one here, trust Jesus to here and now take the circumstances of our lives and bring us life and blessing. That is his desire, and it is for us to come to know ever more deeply his love for us. Let's sing again a wonderful hymn, Amazing Grace. be seated. Let us continue in prayer. God of amazing grace and wonderful glory, we thank you for Charlie, who both gave and received love and whose soul's now departed this earthly life. We thank you for the friendship he gave, for the good and gracious things he brought. And we thank you for the love he offered and received while he was with us. We pray that all which was good in Charlie's life will continue to benefit those whose lives he touched, that all that was important to him will be respected by those who follow, and that the things in which he was great will continue to hold much meaning for us now that he has passed on. We ask that he may go on living in part in his family and his friends, in their hearts and minds, in their courage and their consciences. We ask you that those who were close to him may find themselves bound ever closer to each other, and that we may, in peace and friendship here on earth, always be deeply conscious of your promise to be faithful to us in our need. We pray for ourselves that you would help us bear the burden of our losses, and that you would enable us both to face the realities of our lives and grow ever stronger in our fellowship with one another. And so grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who has taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, You are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, and yet, even at the grave, we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. To your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Charlie. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Now the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Please rise for the family. Thank you.
hand. Lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my precious love, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day is past and at the river I stand, guide my feet, hold my hand, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I'm tired, I'm weak, I'm worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious love, lead me home, lead me home.
The chimes of time ring out the news, another day is through. Someone slipped and fell. Was that someone you? You may have longed for added strength, your courage to renew. Do not be disheartened. I have news for you. It is no secret what God can do, what He's done for others, He'll do for you. With arms wide open, He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. There is no night, for in His light you'll never walk alone. You'll always feel at home wherever you may roam. There is no power can conquer you while God is on your side. Take Him at His promise, Don't run away and hide. It is no secret what God can do, what He's done for others, He'll do for you. With arms wide open, He'll pardon you. It is no secret what God can do. I love because you understand, dear, every single thing I try to do. You're always there to lend a helping hand, dear. I love you most of all because you're you. No matter what the world may say about me, I know your love will always see me through. I love you for the way you never doubt me, but most of all I love you 'cause you're you. I love you because my heart is lighter every time I'm walking by your side. I love you because the future's brighter, the door to happiness you open wide. No matter what the world may say about me, I know your love will always see. Most of all, I love you 'cause you're you.
I got sent home from school one day with a shiner on my eye. Fighting was against the rules and it didn't matter why. Dad got home, I told that story just like I'd rehearsed. Then stood there on those trembling knees and waited for the worst. And he said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. He said daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen. When I became a father in the spring of 81, there was no doubt that stubborn boy was just like my father's son. When I thought my patience had been tested to the end, I took my daddy's secret and I passed it on to him. I said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. A Said daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen. Last night I dreamed I died and stood outside those pearly gates. When suddenly I realized there must be some mistake. If they know half the things I've done, they'll never let me in. Then somewhere from the other side, I heard these words again. And they said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love. A secret that my daddy said was just between us. You see, daddies don't just love their children every now and then. It's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen.
I remember daddy's hands folded silently in prayer and reaching out to hold me when I had a nightmare. You could read quite a story in the calluses and lines. Years of work and worry had left their mark behind. I remember daddy's hands, how they held my mama tight and patted my back for something done right. There are things that I've forgotten that I loved about the man, but I'll always remember the love in daddy's hands. Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I until they bled, sacrificed unselfishly just to keep us all fed. If I could do things over, I'd live my life again and never take for granted the love and daddy. Steal when I'd done wrong. Daddy's hands weren't always gentle, but I've come to understand there was always love in daddy's hands. Daddy's hands were soft and kind when I was crying. Daddy's hands were hard as steel when I'd done wrong.
Down to the old place a couple of days ago, where I grew up right next to you, learning everything I know. I noticed just how green things were when I pulled through the gate, like the greener pastures up there where we'll meet again someday. I shot a thought to slip a phone in the pocket of your suit,
when the good Lord called you home on that sunny day in June. That I could send a picture of all the things you touched, to think a man who lived such a simple life could leave behind so much. It's just a lot of little things, but they mean the world to me. Everywhere I look, there's one more memory. There's a little bit of you in everything I see. Seems to rain now all the time. Hadn't seen this much in years. Didn't take you long to send back home some answers to our prayers. A lot of things are different now, but so much is still the same. And I accidentally dial your number almost every day. Wish I'd have thought to slip a phone in the pocket of your suit when the good Lord called you home on that sunny day in June. That I could send a picture of all the things you touched, to think a man who led such a simple life could leave behind so much. It's just a lot of little things, but they mean the world to me. Everywhere I look, there's one more memory. There's a little bit of you in everything I see. If somehow you could find that cloud with my stuff locked away, dust it off and you can see the things I send you every day. Yeah, I could send a picture of your great-grandson growing up, tell you one more time I love you and that I miss you so much. Sometimes it's the little things that really get to me. Everywhere I look, there's one more memory. There's a little bit of you in everything I see. Everywhere I look, there's one more memory. There's a little bit of you in everything I see.
start this day like all the rest. First thing every morning that I do is start missing you. Some broken hearts never mend. Some memories never end. Some tears will never dry. My love for you will never die. Superstars, organic food and foreign cars. I don't believe the price of gold, the certainty of growing old, that right is right and left is wrong, that north and south can't get along, that east is east and west is west, and being first is always best. But I believe in love. I believe in I believe in mom and dad, and I believe in you. Well, I don't believe that heaven waits for only those who congregate. I like to think of God as love. He's down below, he's up above. He's watching people everywhere. He knows who does and doesn't care. And I'm an ordinary man. Sometimes I wonder who I am. But I believe in love. I believe in music. I believe in magic. And I believe I know with all my certainty what's going on with you and me is a good thing. It's true. I believe in you. I don't believe virginity is as common as it used to be. In working days and sleeping nights, that black is black and white is white, that Superman and Robin Hood are still alive in Hollywood, that gasoline's in short supply, the rising cost of getting by. But I believe in love. I believe in old folks.
I believe in children. I believe in you. I believe in love. I believe in babies. I believe in mom and dad. And I believe in you.
This is